painting here is really special to me because this painting here represents kind of what I was feeling as a young man. I was looking for a role model, and then at that time I really had none. I wasn't very close to my father, my parents, whatever, and I was just floundering. Then one day I went to see, I think I was 12 years old, I went to see Hercules, Steve Reeves, and all of a sudden I saw something that ended up changing my entire life. I said, that is the male image I want to be. That is something that'll make me forget who I am and the way his body, his size, and everything. And then I did. I changed my physique. I did everything. And then as I got older and I realized that Hercules isn't really Hercules, and he isn't that man, and that the character I was playing, the superstar, the superheroes, are very fallible. And in the end, they sometimes are very, very self-destructive. So that's why at the very end, they self-destruct, like the wound to the head, and eventually he imposes his own demise. But for that very brief time, he burns bright and looks invincible, but nothing's invincible. This painting here is kind of an experiment, an interesting, where I would take the words, said, how do you combine the feelings that you have inside also with the actual imagery? So I took the words from Rocky, that it's a miraculous occurrence that it actually happened, the words from Rocky. I put it on canvas, and then I took one of the more important moments, why he does what he does, what it means to be a champion and a winner. He goes, and when that bell rings and I'm left standing, I'm gonna know for the first time in my life that I weren't just another bum from the neighborhood, that he's going to define himself. This is his moment. This is the legacy. It's not winning, it's just surviving. And I have found that, you know, so many people have related to that. And there's no, his expression, there's no self-grandeur, there's no defiance. It's just actually a tremendous fear. This is his literally moment of truth. And he's not sure he can do it. And he's hoping so that his words will get him through as much as his actions.
There's always the hero and the faiblesse, the weakness.
Yes.
In almost all of the works.
Because I think what really makes the hero is the fact that the hero truly doubts that he can do it. Uh-huh. So we become his supporter. Nothing to me is worse than arrogance.
Yes.
Like, we're so defiant, even though you need that kind of arrogance sometimes, I think it doesn't translate as human. It becomes...
It's a fake.
It is fake. We know you're scared. Uh-huh. Everyone's scared. I've seen all the heroes in the world.
Yeah.
I played them all, and I know inside. Even when I, and I know it's pretend, it's a game, it's a facade. Everything's a mask. Everything's like a Greek mask,
uh-huh.
Totally. Talking about masks, this is something that has been percolated in my mind. You know, Michael Jackson is always perceived as this great entertainer, but I think his legacy also provides a great insight into my world, the world of, again, make-believe, entertainment, illusion. And I always felt that Michael Jackson was one of the great dichotomies, and an illusionist, even more than a singer. He created a character that wasn't even him anymore. He became something other. And he tried to manifest that in the way he would dress, in the way he would look, in the way he changed his entire physicality to become something different. But more importantly, I always felt that his brain was being pulled in two different directions. One being very influenced by young, angelic people or images or impressions or children. He just was drawn towards that. And the fact that there was an evil side, that truly again, it's even a handsome evil. It's not a dark way. It's a theatrical evil. And I think he wore that mask very, very well. Because he fooled people by trying to be very childlike, and that's why I put the flowers in there. Mm-hmm. It's kind of kitschy, like, oh, a man like this could never be mm-hmm. like that. Mm-hmm. When in fact, deep down inside, you strip off the clothes, he sees himself as a very aggressive human being, even though he comes off as this passive individual. Michael Jackson was a dynamo, and he was one big ball of contradictions and confusions. Talent, without a doubt, but it came at a terrible price, too. It's kind of tragic, but the truth is, the characters we play are usually the byproduct of someone else's creative mind. And eventually, that's all going to crumble and fade away. And you're left alive looking at yourself in the mirror. And most of them don't like what they see. And they begin to, I think, self-destruct. That's why I hate when we see biographies of performers. The first three quarters of the biography is wonderful. He had children. He was rich. And then when we come back after a commercial, the downside. And very few get out alive, emotionally alive. I've always said that an artist dies twice. And the second time he dies, the physical death, that's the easy one. The professional, the day he has to take off his mask and be... It's a death,
yes.
And no one respects. You're like, oh, you're just a right. You're not special anymore. You're just like me.
Like a quick downfall.
Yes,
like
you're just an aging old person.
The Dorian Gray idea.
Yes, the Dorian.
Is that something that has?
Completely. And Dorian, I think Oscar Wilde was more than he was looking into the soul of an actor when he wrote it. It really was. And I think all actors, really great actors, they have to be unrealistic. The last thing you want is a realistic actor, because he doesn't want to be real. He lives in this world,
so this
netherworld.
So the paintings, I mean, they're important to you. I mean, they've always been important.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I've always, I try to put the emotional intent on there, because I know what they're feeling. I go through it myself. And this is the world I understand. Then I realized, you know, maybe it's just a microcosm of everybody in their own little way has their own dramas, and they're not far from this either. Like when I did Rocky, I thought, well, I'm just gonna do my personal story. Then I realized it translated in every language. Everyone has that need to at least have an opportunity, otherwise they die inside. And I go, wow. That's everybody. Mm-hmm. So even though these are big theatrical, because that's the world I know, the people inside of them, underneath Michael, are very small, regular, everyday people.
And the personal historic references.
Oh, this one here. This is an odd experiment. In the beginning of Rocky, I got so many pictures and people, and they were really writing my character. They were writing to the character of Rocky, which is symbolized here. And
with a big heart.
With a big heart, I know. Why the heart is here, I don't know. Again, it's subconscious, I don't know, things just happen. And this idea that he's waving out and reaching out, I wanted to take letters from all corners of the world, and the printing and the words are so beautifully done, and actually, some of them actually have a feel as though they're quite antique. The kids don't look contemporary. Many of them look as though they come from the 30s and the 40s, and it's just very odd. So anyway, I put it all down, and the way I usually sign back to people that have sent me things is I put best of life Sly Stallone. So I thought, let me write one big giant love letter back to them, but also cover it in a way that it's eternally sealed. This is like waterproof. I wanted to conserve the moment, put my hand here, and it's like I'm reaching out, I'm trying to touch them. So this is just a love letter back to them in kind of a Stallone way of responding.
Very successfully.
Thanks. This painting is based on James Dean, and people say, "Wow, it doesn't look like James Dean at all." I said, "Well, it's I think it has the. I'm trying to capture the feeling of James Dean in the sense that He was very much like many of young men today. They're somewhat lost and they're looking for a role model. I felt that James Dean tried to do something that he really wasn't, and eventually it may even have cost him his life. But on this particular surface here, I try to put a dark base and then I cover it with a very thick coating of white paint with a heavy oil base, and then slowly peel it away, like we try to peel away the patina or the armor or the cover of our heroes to see what really makes them tick. James Dean was very influenced by Brando, but he never had that kind of fortitude, the size of Brando. He was more, he had a much more feminine side. He had a more gentle side. He had a more artistic and sensitive side. So he created this whole different kind of allure that today it's being duplicated, that he set a standard that many, many performers today look to him as the antithesis. You look at the characters in Twilight or, some of the things that Johnny Depp has done, so many have influenced him because what he represents is that male, female, that incredible dichotomy that makes for a great performer, that internal confusion and ability to get their emotions to the surface. Well, here too, I put a patch over because I don't think a lot of the actors and a lot of characters, they really don't see life clearly. They sort of put a blinders on and see it the way they want to see it. And eventually, I think he died tragically trying to be something that he really wasn't. And that quite often causes us to self-destruct, is when we try to pretend to be something we're not. And that's pretty much what this great artist he was, for sure. But there was other demons at work. And that usually, in a way, makes for a great performance. Most of the fantastic artists I've come across are completely at odds with their demons. Their work, usually the best work that comes about, is when they're in an unhappy state. That's when they can put forth their true angst, and that's what this is.
And the choice of white?
The choice of white is kind of a purity factor that nothing quite captured like white. And I thought that he was seen as this virginal character, this fellow who was hadn't been blemished by life. He was revered almost like a deity. Mm-hmm. When he died, it was like a god died. The day James Dean died was when a certain kind of acting, a certain kind of character was never revived again. We have had hundreds of imitators, but the whiteness here. So it there's this, again, dichotomy. Deep down inside, this is the color of the performer. This is what they tend to cover the true self with, is a patina of like, I'm an artiste, I'm above it all, I'm not of this world, when it's not true. Mm-hmm. When it's not true. This is a painting when I had first met the woman I married, Jennifer. I was just going out with her, and at that time I was full of a great deal of confusion and rebellion, and I didn't treat her as I should have treated her. So my life was totally chaotic, as you see my eye coming through there. There's not much life in it. Actually, it looks somewhat withdrawn. And that was her initials, JF. And I had her actually sign it herself. This was a testament of how badly I misbehaved in the past. I just broke her heart many, many times. So slowly I kept adding to this. Recently is a few months ago, starting back in 88. Before, you start out as like lust and pride and all the things that make you stay away from, I don't want to be owned by anyone. I don't want to be tied down by anybody. I want to feel vulnerable to anybody. So you push them away, until finally you end up pushing yourself over an abyss. You lose the opportunity to love something. So the explosion that's out of this is an ongoing situation. It's like this thing will never heal. This thing, if I came back, it would keep going, But anyway, it was like finally, It goes, if you go hurt, will eventually, if you stay in there, hurt will equal win. You will survive. And, you know, hurt equals win. I know it's like in 96, but eventually you do. And then finally I signed it, you know, like, sorry. Love you, baby. Just kidding. That's what I love about painting, because I think that if it's the one true communication you can have with, like with writing. Writing is wonderful, but it can be manipulated, it can be edited and so on. Painting it's the fastest and purest translator of your subconscious. When you have something going on and you hit that canvas, it's hard to fake it. It usually it's pretty true. Mm-hmm. You can come, and I come back and I look at it a week later and go, whoa, that's what I was thinking? Wow. Whereas in writing, you can change the words a little bit and edit it, and not with painting. Painting is the purest communication up from artist to result. Artist to canvas is, to me, numero uno in conveying one's feelings.
Can we talk about this one here? This is the first.
Oh, this is the earliest. I did this a long time ago. I actually did it in 74. I knew I wanted to do Rocky. I knew I wanted to tell this story, but it was going around in my head, but I wasn't sure how it should look or feel. So I started out, I said, let me try to put it visually what it is. And I said, okay, he comes from the city, and his world is dark, nighttime, purple. This is a guy who really doesn't have any sunshine in his life. So the city be here. And then I would take, I thought, words from sporting pages. 10 rounds, 8:45 p.m. for money, boxing, professional arena. And it's just one subject, which means this fella here is obviously involved in fighting. So this is Rocky. And I wanted this to be pretty mechanical. I'm not sure why, but I wanted to be not like a painting per se. So I want to be like a cave drawing. So I did his outline. Then I took a blunt instrument like a screwdriver and carved it. So I wanted to carve the character like you would carve a sculpture, and what came out I thought was the right attitude. It just happened. I went, yeah, that's, so I went from that to writing the screenplay. That was before the screenplay was even written. I see. The screenplay was written in late 75. This was, and I did it for almost like four or five other characters too, but this is the one that survived.
And the red eyes?
And the red eyes, because you know that the pain, if you look into a boxer's eyes, that's where most of the pain is absorbed, because that's, they see the pain, they see the brutality, and that also is kind of a mirror or a record of what kind of fighter they are. A good fighter would be clean, nice. This is a man who is quite accompanied and quite used to pain. Uh-huh. And so he can see that he's accepted his lot, that I'm not a good fighter, but I'm not a great fighter. I fight great fighters.
Uh-huh. But also using a screwdriver is a painful thing.
It's like absolutely. Yeah, it was something very interesting about it. I've never done it since. It's just one time. It's just that I felt like I couldn't get it with the brush. I couldn't get it. I tried with my fingernail, couldn't get it. I thought, you know, it's mechanical, something. And that's why it came, all these interesting lines came out of it. Really, And that also was the beginning of me working with a palette knife. Mm-hmm. I had such a good experience with this. I said, let me take it and see how far I can go with it. And I haven't looked back since, but that was,
and I think another early painting is,
this is the first time that I was in Iowa in a small hotel room. We were doing a film called Fist, and the woman that was pretty much responsible for taking me out of the shadows, and the first one, not my mother, her name was Jane Oliver. She was my manager, and she died, and she wouldn't tell me she was dying. I just one day heard she's dead. I went, oh. So I went back to my room, and I went I went down to a hardware store, and I found some implements and paint, a small brush, and I just painted the feeling that, you know, the life's blood coursing from her is like a conveyor belt, and it's flowing downstream, and I just took my heart out, put it on there, and realized it would never be the same. It would just float away. That's why I put the actual date, 6-3-77. The son of obviously is in mourning. But that this was a, and the physique is, you know, it's you're so, you seem like, again, the superhuman creature, the superhero, but heartless, alone, pretty vulnerable, looking off into nothing. And every Rocky film since then has always been dedicated to her at the very end of every film. Mm-hmm. From one on, it's an enduring memory of Jane Oliver. And this painting, just I got the phone call, boom, went and started painting. This is not normally my style. This is much more delicate and contained and, I guess, withdrawn. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I tend to be very quiet, and that's not my nature. So, yeah, you're right.
Interesting.
It is. The menace, the Life magazine, I always was fascinated with Life magazine, the covers themselves. They were usually showing the actors, America's royalty, in the most flattering of lights. Always grand, always beautiful, always perfectly lit. And then I thought, well, how life has changed. My Life magazine would be something quite different. It'd be a sign of the times, how it's threatening, it's coming at you, that this is life as we know it today. It's very fragile and quite often aggressive and volatile. Not the passive, beautiful, black and white world that we had in the 50s and 60s. Then I thought, after I did that, I would go to museums and I'd watch people watching paintings and how they change. They themselves became different people. Quite often they probably wouldn't even recognize themselves if they saw themselves. How when they're pondering a piece of art, they just take on gestures, they'll stand and they move and yeah. And they go off and in their own little world. So I put a mirror here. So people would catch themselves how they look to a painting, as a painting's looking at you, how you look when you stare at a painting. You look quite different. Even though a painting's aggressive,
it's like posed,
very much so. So I thought, that's it. This is what you look like when you're looking at something.
And you chose a very old master frame.
I wanted this to be really like something that was in complete contrast to that image. Mm-hmm. It just was all contradictory. He's contradictory to life. The frame is contradictory to what it should be. And an old-fashioned bevel. It's like, so, oh, you're at a museum of sorts, or you're at Versailles or some place. It's just, I think the frames have really evolved. I thought, boy, frame, what is a frame? Framing. People, framing means to hold in. Then I realized that you really can't hold in anything, no matter what. Anything that has come out of your subconscious, and that's just not for painting, anything, art. Every artist I've ever met says, I wish I could do that over again. So on paintings like this, I started putting frames that are incomplete to constantly remind me that art is always evolving. No frame can ever hold it in. It will overgrow. If this were actually animated in years, the painting would grow out to here. It would just continue to evolve. So I do believe that all art evolves. I mean, not physically evolve, but in the artist's mind, it's never done, ever. I don't think. I love abstracts, and I think that so many great abstract painters have found a certain style that is all their own, and you can see it from a half a mile away and you know exactly who that artist is. I thought it's fascinating. And it's not so easy to find something that you truly connect with. And I said, God, I love doing abstracts, but I tried different things and everything was somewhat derivative of artists we've seen before. Then I was looking at a photograph almost from space. It was the ocean. And as the ocean crashed onto the sand, this was like foam. And this was the beach. And these dots were the actual people laying on the beach. And the more I pulled back from it, it started to take on, I said, this, I don't know why, but I see it as very sensual. I saw it as the beginning of a style where I've always believed in the joining together of man and woman as kind of a natural union, but it's also a difficult fit at times because quite often the man, this side, the darker side, needs the nourishment of the female. And on later, and you'll see maybe later abstracts, I started to paint the side of the male, but this section here would always be somewhat faded. It would be transparent, because I believe that the life giver, the woman, has a much more concrete foundation. I believe that's why they've been the subject of so many great sculpture, is the female form in its solid base. And the man, by mere nature, because of, and also some of the pressure that's put on him, quite often needs the support constantly to keep that faith in himself alive. There's always that void. I think that mother void, it's never, ever full. It never, at least the men I know, no matter how rugged they are, there's still that little part of him, that young child inside that still cries out to be protected. And people say, oh, no, but I've seen it. So the red strip, of course, it becomes very sensual to me, and it becomes a matter of the joining of the sexes. So it's a sexual act, and this is the first one. This is like the prototype. The other ones have been a little bit more defined than the other abstracts, but this was the basis for the first one, and very personal afterwards. But I love that imaging because it's extremely volatile, yet over here is very, very passive. These two passive entities come together, and when they join together, sparks fly. I mean, this is the most important union in life. This is what I think so much of art is based on, is that coming together either joyfully or unhappily. So much in the union of male and female, if it's a joyous occasion, it can be, if it's not, it has to come out. Usually so many artists are tormented, or people that achieve things in their life, it's all because that union has not been satisfactory, so they have to become successful or try in some other fashion, which in some ways is a good thing because it's created some incredible art and literature because of the sexual angst.
That's fantastic.
That make sense?
Oh, absolutely.
If you're just winging it to try for sensationalism, say, oh, and people come, God, that's really bold, that's amazing, but there's nothing behind it. Mm-hmm. When I find I'm actually painting an emotion, that's a female side and that's a male side, mm-hmm. It really influences the way you apply the paint, the pressure, and the coloration. I mean, it really does. If you are actually going in with a plan and not, as we say in the world of acting, ad-libbing, mm-hmm, you're just ad-libbing, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Or as they say, your feet are moving so fast you can't tell if your shoes aren't shined. In other words, you're actually trying to convey something. That's why I look at some of the master's abstracts, and at first you go, oh, and then you look at it and you go, whoa, now you get it. Mm-hmm. You can feel that this man was bleeding over this canvas. He was just pouring it all out. Because he was trying to convey, he's actually trying to reach out and give you a piece of his body. Every time I think a great painting, it's like you literally have took a piece of his soul. This is when I was going through a series, in which I really enjoy doing, looking at actors who had one face for the public. This was supposedly at the time the most famous comedian in the world, W.C. Fields. And everyone saw him as this lovable buffoon, but in fact he was an incredibly intense, pained, orphaned, unhappy individual who trusted nobody. And no matter how much glory he reaped from his audience, he hated himself and he hated his life, and eventually he just withdrew until, like the time says, it's like 11 o'clock at 12 o'clock, usually it means the end of one's life, until he just in self-destructed. And it was all he cared about was, I need money, because he lived so poorly. He never was ever paid. He had to be paid in gold, just gold. He wouldn't accept dollars. He didn't believe it. He never went to a bank. He buried it in his backyard, really. So his coat is green. It's all about money. That's all he was, money. And the fleshness of being just like his own personal hell, that's what the redness is about. And he was destroyed from gin. It was just terrible. I said, my God, here's a man who had everything against him, yet he went to Hollywood, became in his own way a king, very, very successful. But those early years, you never can escape them. Quite often they make you a prisoner to your past, and all the glory, you still can't get past the fact that you had no love coming up. You were never appreciated. There's always that insecurity, that darkness, and that mistrust. It's like a poor animal that has been mistreated as a puppy. It grows up shy and withdrawn. So that's what that's about.
Thank you as well.
I know, the layers, I think, because our life is layered. Nothing is what it seems, ever. It's like our clothing. We keep adding clothing as we get, and it's very hard to get to the real person, especially as we get older. That's why you say it's so hard to make new friends, really good friends, once you're past 30. It's pretty hard, really. You make acquaintances because we put on so many layers and we have so many protective coats of varnish that it's hard to get through. Well, like, this is sort of a painful subject. When this is my second marriage with Bridget Nielsen, and I thought she was this extraordinary creature, and she was, but it was just not meant to be. The entire union was entered into under false pretenses, and it never was to be. And that's why the black is beginning to encroach here, and because she was blonde, but it's saying that we should have just covered this entire relationship over, like you would cover an asphalt road. Just start over again. Just bury that entire life in 85. And that's what this is all about, how this encroachment of the black is eventually going to envelop this and start over. And that's what I did with the wonderful woman. But that's what this is about. There's no love in the eyes. There's no attachment. It's as cold and unforgiving as possible. Just a marriage made in a hellish situation.
And the biggest clock in all of your paintings.
Yeah.
So far.
And because this.
Again and again, as a symbol.
When I was married at this time, this became a big public affair, and I was married at Blenheim Palace, and everyone knew about it. So the time I spent with her was chronicled in all the papers, and it was just very, very obvious. So there was nothing subtle about our time together, and that's why I put the clock there. It's like this intruding thing, because the marriage lasted maybe 300 days. So the clock was very, very clock is very important to me. In all facets of the arts, because there's never enough time, never enough time, never enough time in your life. At least I've always felt that way. So I've been very driven by the clock. It's fascinating. I'm surprised I'm not a watchmaker. I'm fascinated by it. So this was early on in the relationship, but you could see the darkness of the hands. This was a complete and utter misunderstanding of emotions. Mm. Yeah.
But the clock is used also in this particular case because time is running out, but you also use it to symbolize at what stage of life.
Yes, exactly. This, if we start at one being the very birth of relationship, this is nine. This is when I knew. I was in 86, it was over. So this was the good times were gone. This is kind of depressing. I was doing again, a lot of my films are based on my experience in an alternate universe, which is filmmaking. It's, we are trying to duplicate life, but not really. We can't. We can only fake it. We can only do it in a superficial way. So this is a film I was doing, doing Tango and Cash, and the constant questions, yes, no, people believing it, am I coming across, are my emotions fake, is this ever, are people going to buy what I'm doing, so close yet not. You never, when you're out there pretending to be someone, you're never satisfied with, you always feel as though you've failed. So performers are always in a constant state of insecurity. They may say they nailed it, but I've never heard anyone ever say they couldn't have done it better. So it's these constant choices of making. So I did this in a very kind of like a blueprint way, and not trying to put too much detail in there. It's out of our hands. Our performers and everything else are really at the behest of the director. He is God. We are merely just his stick drawings. We're his tools, his vessel to create his film. We are not the hub. We are just the spokes on his wheel. So that's what that's about.
And that's also where you start to expand over the canvas.
Yeah. I started to move it out. Should I do this? Because I started with, I did a painting with Rambo at home. And in the films, it just this constant explosion. I said, if you were able to carry out the explosion on film, it would go right onto the curtains and onto the audience. It would just keep going. So I thought, let me try to have the painting continue to arc forward, that it's encroaching literally beyond its bounds, that there is no limit to perhaps its influence. It just wants to continue to move out, like a living creature.
It's like reaching out.
Yes, reaching out. It's like vines. It's moving out, and I just thought I felt it kind of fascinating, and I cover it in a very, very heavy industrial varnish that's used primarily for yachts, for industrial purposes. And it makes, I don't know, there's something nautical. I love the idea that it's a working man's varnish. It's not meant to be delicate. It's meant to be substantial and like concrete. It's grounded and heavy, and it gives it its amber glow.
Is it also part of that quest for eternity?
Yeah, it's funny. The varnish also makes the painting almost impervious to the elements. If this were to go outside and be snowed on, it wouldn't affect it at all. Like a boat, like a piece of machinery, like something that you wouldn't imagine. You know, art is always so fragile. Like, my God, if the temperature is down. I said, what if I made art that would be confrontational? And you could put it outside there and nothing's going to happen. It's as safe as your car or a house. It's called dictator style. If there is such a thing as dictator style, there is a what makes a dictator, what kind of incredible arrogance and power and the belief that people would allow this person to, this horrible person to overrun their lives, but they continually do. So I try to, This is the angst that he caused and the pain, and it was done on a very industrial, it was like silver paint, and then I covered it in a varnish, gave it more of a golden glow, which relates to gold and wealth. But you can see the blood and the chaos and the mayhem and the completely relenting, unsympathetic eyes that just continue to count down on the survival of whatever he is. In other words, there is no way that the land that he governs is ever going to get better. It's getting less and less and less. Yet he will go, all my children. And like he'll preach, oh, it's all my children, or all my, I love all of you. But in a sense, but if you dare to disagree with me, I'll kill you all. So this is a bigger than life statement about dictator style. And I did one other painting that goes along with that. It's a very interesting subject. Because dictators have no style. They think that they're actually borderline insane. They're garish, they're loud, they're bombastic, they're egocentric to the point where every statue must be them. There's zero tolerance for any other person in the realm of their domain. None. Zero. So I thought, okay. Dictator style, mayhem. 1957. That's, you know, we're getting back into Castro. I'm so impressed with colors. It's that's how I tell my choices, through colors. Yeah, I you know, you wish you were more of a draftsman and you could just do it through a fine and delicate expressions, but I do it through emotions, through colors, through the actual the passion inside. It's like it's interesting when you see, they do brain scans and you can see part of the lobes, and it's yellow and it's red and it's blue, and you can actually trace emotions. Yes, and it's no coincidence that when we see it in person, it subliminally, yes, those are the kind of, it's the yellow and the blue, the heat I feel in my mind, it's on canvas. So if I can get that out of this onto that, I've succeeded. Until I do, it's a failure. So sometimes it takes a while.
So you do destroy paintings or you leave them and overpaint them?
That's quite like the ones that I realize are just hopeless, I give to my brother. And the other ones I just keep painting and painting and painting and painting, and it may take, like the one with my wife there, it could take 10 years, 15 years, really. I'm finally happy with that painting. Before, I haven't been happy with that painting since 1989.
So what would say you are impatient, patient man?
Impatiently patient.
Fantastic, thank you very much.
Oh, you're welcome.